students. So, to anchor the cry from within, I want to tell you a story about that. One of our practicing members, Leanne Travers, who started, I remember when she first came to the primer classes where we were still in the house. And I remember she really liking the classes. Now it's called The Foundations of Mindfulness. And we got to talking maybe a few years later, and she told me that she went to Hawaii occasionally, and there was a very special place there that she loved to be at. And it was, she told me it's the birthing stones on Oahu. I said, oh, that sounds really interesting, the birthing stones, right? So she says that's where she goes for peace. And so it happened maybe about 5 years ago. I happened to be on Oahu when Leanne was on Oahu too, because she said, you know what, I'll take you there. I said, great, okay. So I also had a friend, he studied La'au Lapa'au, which is the healing. They were the traditional doctors of old Hawaii, and he healed with the plants, the many, over 5,000 plants he knew. And but he said healing was 80% spiritual, 20% the plants. That's what, because I studied with him for 5 years. So it was here that I learned about the birthing stone. So one of my La'au brothers, La'au meaning healing plants, was on Oahu, and I contacted him because I wanted to have someone who was Hawaiian to also go to this place, because I found out it was where the women, the female chiefs, would give birth at. And it's a beautiful, it's in the center of Oahu, a little bit high elevation, with these huge rocks amidst beautiful trees, just graceful trees. Very peaceful there. But anyway, I wanted to have a Hawaiian to also go with Leanne and me, because, you know, when you are in Hawaii, you know, there are sacred places that you need to be careful. You need to be mindful and careful when you go to these places. You can't just like walk over there a lot of places, because things could happen if you were not mindful. So I asked Roddy to come with us, Roddy Akau. And so we went up there, and you know, it's kind of a nondescript place. There's like a gate that is a dirt road. Sometimes the gate is open, sometimes the gate is not. And it's, I believe, a public place being taken care of by a Hawaiian group, Hawaiian Civic Club. So the gate was open that day, which is great. It was in the afternoon. And so we drove in this little dirt road, and there's little, you know, kind of parking places on the dirt, you know, road that ends. Not very big. And then we quietly walked to this place. It's not a place where you, you know, talk as you walk. It's just, it just kind of is that place that you're like, okay, but this is like a meditation walk. It's like an internal thing as you walk there. And beautiful, all different kinds of rocks, which I imagine the women, you know, may have been sitting on or lying on when they were giving birth there. And at one point, you know, I was sitting there. I didn't know if I should sit on the rock or what, you know. It's like, you just got to be careful, you know. And so I said, Roddy, is it okay, you know, to be here? You know, so felt so very spiritual and sacred to me said, "Don't worry, I've got you covered." I was like, "Okay, great, I can relax now a little bit in this place." So the name of the place is Ku Kani Loko. So like here, you know, and there they have names of streets, Hawaiian, pretty much Hawaiian, like names of chiefs like Kamehameha Avenue, he was the first chief, Keawe Lane. Here, you know, we have Lake Street, right? In Hawaii, a lot of times they name places for the aura, the atmosphere of the place. So Ku Kani Loko, I never really knew what that meant. I never looked it up. I mean, I could have. But that was our wonderful experience there. Very peaceful, very calming, very grounding there. And it's said that when women give birth there, the chiefesses, there was no pain. And only certain chiefesses could give birth there if their family did not practice or their husband did not practice human sacrifice, they could give birth there. Mm-hmm. So it's not for everybody, very special place. So this August we had Kuana Torres Kahele, a very talented Hawaiian man, come here to this place to teach a workshop, which I didn't plan. It just sort of happened that the venue he was going to perform at fell through at like the last minute. And so I got a call like a week before saying, you know, this happened and, you know, what should we do? And I said, well, in any case, just use this as your safety net. You just come here. If nothing else works out, we can work it out here. So he did. And he brought an ukulele class, kind of like a little advanced ukulele class, which was fun to have 17 people in here playing ukulele. That was very nice. And he showed us the Hawaii. Each island has a different strum. So he showed us the Hawaii Island strum. It was like, oh my God, okay, it's going to take a while to master that one. And then in the afternoon, he taught an ancient dance called In Honor of Poliahu, which is the deity of Mauna Kea, deity of the snows, also the deity of compassion. And of course, we had Avalokiteshvara there against the wall, and I asked him, is it okay, you know, if Avalokiteshvara is here? He said, well, and I told him who Avalokiteshvara was, the deity of compassion, and he said, well, you know, it doesn't hurt to have compassion in the room. And I had signed up for his hula workshop ahead of time about this place, Ku Kani Loko, and because I thought it was actually, you know, brother is Israel Kamaka Bivaole, who sings Somewhere Over the Rainbow, right? Yeah. I thought it was his version of Ku Kani Loko, and then I Googled, you know, to see what the dance might look like. And what I saw, I was not impressed. So I was going to just like not go this. And Joy, you know, I said, Joy, you go. And she goes, you're not going? I'm like, no, I don't think so. But because he was here on Friday, I felt I need to go because I can't just blow it off. So I'm so happy that I went because the song is absolutely gorgeous that he wrote about this place. And then the choreography is absolutely gorgeous. And we're gonna be dancing it at our annual luncheon. Mm-hmm. So you'll see the dance. So I asked him, and he told us, you know, Ku Kani Loko means to anchor the cry from within. Mm-hmm. That's what he told us as he was teaching us the dance. And I said, well, that's interesting. I like that, to anchor the cry from within. You know, this is a place where women give birth. I mean, that is a miraculous experience for sure, right? To anchor the interesting. A huge pain that I can imagine, right? I can't imagine it anyway. So I texted him, Facebook Messenger. I said, what is your manao? What is your thinking about this title? You know, why did you write this song? He's the composer, so, you know, always a composer has something in mind. And in Hawaiian tradition, you know, you ask, you're respectful. You want to ask what the composer had in mind. If you're going to choreograph something, or, but this, he already did the choreography, so I just wanted to get his thinking behind this beautiful, beautiful song. So he texted back, and he said, what I'm referring to is coming to terms with something personally that you are struggling with before acting or deciding how to act. To tether the emotional part and then move forward. This is Zen training. Just so it dovetails together with my hula practice. To tether the emotional part and then move forward. So yesterday we had our second Overcoming Obstacles class for women, and it was about emotions. How to work with emotions. How to tether emotions here before you do or say something that you might regret. And hey, it happens, you know? So we move forward no matter what, right? We learn from these experiences. But if we can just kind of stop and pause, which is what our practice is about, of mindfulness training, and we can integrate this eruption of feeling and emotion that happens because of whatever reason, right? A stimulus has caused this to occur. We're human. So, but the thing is, once it has erupted and you can see it, then you can work with it. If you pause, and for us, it's meditate. And, you know, we may not. So, meditation is very much, mindfulness meditation is very much about being in the body. Because what are we practicing when we're on the cushion? We're practicing being here now. We're in the present. Right? Not in the past. And we're going to find our mind doing that, thinking about past or future, if we're anxious or worried about anything. But the practice is gently bringing your attention back to your breathing, your body, that you're seated here right now in the moment. That's one kind of meditation. There are other kinds of meditation in Zen. You know, we're practicing doing one thing at a time. Right? If you're cleaning, you're just cleaning and you notice thoughts, but then you just come back to what you're doing. That's training your attention. And attention is everything. So one of the essential messages of the Buddha was that it was really important to get to know this experience of dukkha, or suffering. Du means apart from, ka is your experience, suffering. So, tethering it within, anchoring it within is a good way to get to know your suffering, and that may be the last thing that we really want to do when we're suffering. We want to jump up into our heads and solve the problem, because that's, you know, that's generally a habitual way of being with things, especially in our culture today. You know, you can think fast, if you can can speak fast, you know, that's what it's about. You can figure out stuff, but you can't always figure out stuff right away. You know, it takes some digesting sometimes because it's, well, first of all, we can't even hardly be with it, our emotions or our feelings, hardly. But this practice is about patience and building, it's about building patience to do that, which is also about building courage. Courage to face what you don't want to face. And when, the Buddha says, until we know dukkha, we don't really have a way to end it. Constantly distracting ourselves, how are we going to end it? Gotta focus in. Easier said than done, of course. But that's our practice. So the word bhavana is the word often used for meditation. And what that means is literally cultivation. Cultivation. So we are cultivating like gardeners, our lives, right? Gardeners are patient. They're cultivating, they're weeding, they're planting, they're fertilizing. It takes time for things to break down and become rich humus, right? For our lives to grow in. It takes time. And meditation is the fifth perfection of a bodhisattva, right? A bodhisattva, we call them perfections, but they're practices. And does everybody know what a bodhisattva is?
Isn't it one trained to have compassion in the world?
Yes, who trains. Who trains.
Who trains.
Who trains to help others.
Help others.
And help yourself as well. I mean, there's no separation really between you and others. So if you help yourself, you're helping others. If you're helping others, you're helping yourself. So the fifth perfection is a meditation and dhyana. And it's the it refers to the practice of settling and focusing the mind. Interesting noticing, you know, my mind when I was sitting today, kind of jumping around. I was like, okay, come back, come back. But it's a gentle touch also, you know. It's a good thing to notice how busy our minds are. And then you just keep coming back. Yeah, it's a lot of coming back, a lot of coming back. Feeling your bottom on the chair or on the cushion, you know, just feeling into the body. Because we say the body never lies. So, classical descriptions liken the Buddhist path to a tripod, three legs of a tripod. And the first leg is, the first great practice is ethical conduct, ethics. This is like from the Eightfold Path, you know, right speech, right livelihood, right action. That's ethical conduct. The second leg is meditation, which can also samadhi is a term that's used that when you have a strong practice, this samadhi naturally arises, and that's this focused attention. It happens a lot during sessions where you have a longer period to sit. So this is very important, this meditation, this practice, samadhi. And then the third of the legs is understanding or wisdom that arises. And so as with a tripod, right, all legs have to be in balance, perfect balance, because they all support each other. These three things support each other. Norman Fisher has this in his book. So he says, we could say that ethical conduct is the most important of the three because the point of spiritual practice is to live truly and beautifully. To support ethical conduct, we have to practice meditation to stabilize our ordinary shifting mind and heart. When the mind is stable and the conduct pure, deep understanding will arise. Understanding that is more than thinking and wishing, that suffuses identity and feeling. With that suffusion, our behavior will be naturally forthright. Or we could look at it like this. Understanding is the point of spiritual practice. In order to gain it, we have to start with ethical conduct so we can reduce our problems and dramas. Meditation is a necessity for the kind of deep understanding we are aiming for. Understanding that pierces through the veil of ordinary reality. Or we could put meditation in the center of the path. The point of spiritual practice is to live a focused and meditative life beyond the confusion of the everyday. When meditation is our daily practice and approach to life, pure conduct and understanding will naturally arise. So we can look at it in all of those different ways. However we look at it, whichever we think comes first or last, it's clear that the tripod needs all three legs. They always go together. It's as if they are one and the same. So there are these five hindrances to meditation that you might be familiar with.
Only five?
Five big ones. Anyway.
The other ones are subcategories.
I guess so, yes. All right, I'm going to go through them, see if any of these, you know, hit home anywhere, all right? So, attachment, all right, is one hindrance. The mind's obsession with thoughts, emotions, sensations, or images other than the meditation object, which for us is a lot of times is the breath, right? Attachment to thoughts, emotions, sensations, or images other than what we're trying to focus on, right? The next one is aversion, obsessive complaining, and the desire to flee. Aversion. Obsessive complaining and the desire to flee. You ever feel that when you're on the cushion? Okay. The next is flurry and worry. Flurry and worry. The mind and your body jumping all over the place and dredging up things to be concerned about. Doing anything not to stay with the object of concentration. Is concentrating on, right? Flurry and worry. Mind and body, right? Yeah, I noticed my mind jumping and then my body kind of moving also. That was interesting. The fourth is laziness. Now, that has a bad connotation, but here's the definition of laziness. Being sleepy and unmotivated and thus unable to return to the object for lack of interest. You know, sleepy, falling asleep, that's a big one. Yeah. Although in Zen we say, if you're going to sleep, just sleep on the cushion or the chair. Just sleep. Don't feel guilty about it. Just sleep. Doing one thing at a time. Probably need to sleep. Next, the last is doubt. This is a big one. Doubt. Wondering what is the point of doing all this frustrating and boring work? Or doubting one's capacity to do it. That's a big one right there. I can't do this. What am I trying to do? That's a big one because, you know, if you doubt, then you're going to get up. That doubt is strong. So when one or more of these five hindrances are present in their emotional states, concentration can't be there.
Can you say them again?
Yes. What, the hindrances?
The fact.
Yeah. First, attachment, right? Mind's obsession with thoughts, emotions. I just got to think about this now. Attachment. Aversion. Obsessive complaining and desire to flee. Aversion. I don't want to go there. Worry and worry, right? Mind and body jumping all over, dredging up old stuff to be concerned about. Just doing anything not to stay with what you're doing, with the concentration practice, focusing practice. Laziness, being sleepy and unmotivated, and thus unable to return to the focus. Doubt, wondering, what the heck am I sitting here for? Or, you know, I just can't do this. I am not able to do, I can't, I don't have the capacity to do this. That's doubt. So the practice of concentration is about identifying these hindrances. And then patiently working with them. This is the practice, the perfection of patience, another practice of a bodhisattva. Patience, just kind of seeing it, seeing what you're doing, coming back to the breath, doing it again, seeing that you're doing it again, and coming back to the breath, or even the body. Doing the body scan is a good thing. You know, what's here now? Interesting. I really have tense shoulders. What's that about? Being curious. Just letting it be. Letting it go. Okay, so that's there. All right, I'm just going to come back to my breath. Come back to noticing, inhaling, my chest is raising. Or in the belly, just noticing the belly go in and out. This is a great practice for focusing your attention. So that's the work with emotions. Like this, you have to feel it, right? Tether it here, and then you have to notice, what am I feeling? What is this nebulous thing? Wow, my stomach is really churning. What's going on there? It's kind of like your koan. In Zen, we practice koans, which are in traditional, you know, there were these public cases of interactions between Zen masters and their students. And now Eve Marco and Igyoku Nakao, Eve Marco was Bernie Glassman's wife, and Igyoku Nakao is the abbess of the Zen Center of Los Angeles. They're coming. Well, Eve is coming the first weekend in March because their new book, the Book of Householder Koans, Waking Up in the Land of Attachments, is coming out in February. So we're going to have a retreat, a two-day retreat, starting Thursday night for men and women, because these are koans about men and women in their sanghas that they have been working out, these everyday life situations that we're going to contemplate and study. So this, you know, you may not know why your stomach is, but you notice something is up here. In case you didn't know what you were feeling, that's a clue. Because it's not easy to know what you're feeling. In nonviolent communication, it's so interesting to have these lists of feelings, right? There's like easily a whole page of feelings. It's like so many different feelings. The main feelings we know about is angry, sad, happy. You know, there are so many more words that we could kind of be more precise about. Because then when you're precise about it, you're seeing it, then you can work with it. Not necessarily up here, but it's like a whole body working on it. And with the, you know, the tripod, right? This practice of meditation, understanding or wisdom, right, can arise about what's going on. So mindfulness can be pretty, you know, paying attention all the time to what's happening. That's not so easy to do, but it's really important to try to pay attention to what's going on. That's why we sit on the cushion. Because our whole life is sacred. So we want to pay attention to it. So one of the key points in working with emotions is taking full responsibility. Norman Fisher had a really wonderful paragraph about this. He says, "It is within my capacity to understand and alter my gut reaction to the world. It is within my capacity to understand and alter my gut reaction to the world. Here is where I can snap the chain that binds me to suffering. Here is where I can be free. And here is where I need insight." Insight. This insight is not easy to come by. Feeling sensation is barely conscious. Feeling sensation is barely conscious. Barely available as an experience. To access it, I need to do more than think and observe in the usual ways. We think of insight as a cognitive experience, but insight that's fully integrated with concentration practice in all its somatic depth is more than a thought or an understanding. It pervades body, mind, and heart. It transforms emotions, physical sensations, and thoughts. It's the foundation of a new identity. This is why meditation has always been an essential element in the Buddhist project of bringing an end to our ordinary human suffering. Shall I repeat that?
Mm-hmm. Please do.
This insight is not easy to come by. Feeling sensation is barely conscious, barely available as an experience. To access it, I need to do more than think and observe in the usual ways. We think of insight as a cognitive experience, but insight that's fully integrated with concentration practice in all its somatic depth is more than a thought or an understanding. It pervades, insight pervades body, mind, and heart. It transforms emotions, physical sensations, and thoughts. It's the foundation of a new identity. This is why meditation has always been an essential element in the Buddhist project of bringing an end to our ordinary human suffering. So mindfulness is attention training. You can use your trained attention to perceive your own thinking and feeling. Here's a verse by the 14th century Tibetan teacher, Tokme Zangpo. Understanding that emotional reactions are dismantled by insights supported by stillness. Cultivate meditative stability that passes right by the four formless states. This is the practice of a bodhisattva. So the four formless states are evidently like these end stages of meditation where it just, you know, just so blissful. So Tokme Zangpo said, you have to bypass that. Don't get stuck there. You know how we get stuck with things we really like and then it's suffering to get out of it, right? So, you know, it was like, bypass that, because what you want to really basically do is practice meditation enough to be able to live with some understanding and compassion. That's simple. You don't have to become like amazing, you know, whatever we have as our perfection of a person who has meditated tremendously and is so the Dalai Lama, for example, you know. No, but it's just, he's saying simply, just practice it enough to live with some understanding and compassion. Compassion for yourself, compassion for others. Things may get bad, but if you have mental and emotional stability, and if we can see through our emotional reactions, we can bear troubling circumstances much better. We know this. We know this with our practice. And we can be a source and strength to others. I wanted to read this beautiful poem by Rumi, you know, the guest house. This being human is a guest house, every morning a new arrival, a joy, a depression, a meanness. Some momentary awareness comes as an unexpected visitor. Welcome and entertain them all, even if they are a crowd of sorrows, who violently sweep your house empty of its furniture. Still, treat each guest honorably. He may be clearing you out for some new delight. The dark thought, the shame, the malice, meet them at the door laughing, and invite them in. Be grateful for whoever comes, because each has been sent as a guide from beyond. Having this texting with my brother in Hawaii, my youngest brother, who has been having some trouble with his older brother, my younger brother. And you know how family things can go, you know, it's like, and he says, who does that? Who calls the cops on his own nephew? And I said, your brother, Robert. And he said, he's not my brother. Exclamation point. He's not my brother. And I just didn't know what to say. You know, you don't want to get in the middle, but you are in the middle. So I texted him back. Did I ever tell you the story about the talking dog? I texted him. Did I ever tell you the story about the talking dog? So a little while later, he goes, is it a rough story? R-O-U-G-F. Oh. Rough story? L-O-L. Rough, rough. That's pretty darn funny. So they kind of just kind of changed the energy, you know, of the situation. So anyway,
that was a very Zen question you asked.
The colon.
Right, that's right. That was a good answer.
Yeah.
A,
mm-hmm.
A rough story. Rough, rough. Said, everything can be taken from a man or woman, but one thing, the last of human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way. He was in Auschwitz. Talking about emotions, I saw this quote by Joy Harjo, who's the current poet laureate, and she's from the a member of the Muscogee Nation in Oklahoma. She's a wonderful poet. She said in an interview, there were times that I was suicidal. I discovered what could potentially destroy my mind and heart were good building materials. Mm-hmm. Jack Kornfield, we're at the women's retreat, and Chris Dussel, Women's Circle on Friday night, and Chris Dussel had a wonderful list of quotes that she read, and we just kind of reflected, you know, on them. So here's one that she shared by Jack Kornfield. Let go of the battle. Breathe quietly and let it be. Let your body relax and your heart soften. Open to whatever you experience without fighting. And another quote by Jack. If your compassion does not include yourself, it is incomplete. Mm-hmm. got about 15 minutes for some discussion or questions. Okay, the three pillars are the three legs of a tripod. The first is ethical conduct. We study the, we haven't studied it too much, but if you're studying the precepts, the Eightfold Path includes eight ways to end suffering. And ethical conduct includes right livelihood, right speech, right conduct, right illness, right ethical illness, speech, right livelihood, and right something.
Right action.
The second leg is meditation. And with meditation, with a regular practice, samadhi, this focused concentration, can arise. And that's really important. The third leg is wisdom or understanding that also arises with this steady practice of meditation. Wisdom, you know, they all work together. And I want to thank all the people who open up for our meditation times here 3 times a day, 5 days a week. 6 o'clock, these are all free, 6 to 7 a.m. in the morning. And you can sit as long as you want, there are no bells. Noon to 1, same thing, you can sit as long as you want, no bells. And then in the evening, 6 to 6:45, we do have bells, and then we chant the 4 vows at the end. It's 2 20-minute sits. This has been so helpful for me to meditate like this. I can see the difference in my own behavior, thinking. Tremendously important. And it is open to the public. It is free and open to the public. So I invite you, if you have the time, do come. Because you're not only supporting yourself, but you're supporting the other people here who are sitting too. So it's really a wonderful service, I think, that we are providing here. Plus on Sundays. We start at 8:30. The second and fourth Sunday of the month, we do have service at 8 o'clock. Today we did the Gate of Sweet Nectar service. And so on those 2 Sundays, because we're trying to go incense-free on a lot of the days, because some people are sensitive, but on the second and fourth Sunday, we do burn a little incense. We're trying to have Sundays, maybe we'll get into, using something else. Like I know Zen Center of Los Angeles, they use water with lavender buds, and that's what they offer into the water, which is really nice. You could use maybe something else. Tuesdays and Thursdays, totally incense-free. But I've been noticing that we haven't been burning incense. Well, maybe because we ran out of incense also in the incense bowl. So anyway, in the incense box. So I'm very grateful.
Just in case this ever works, I've seen it practiced. I've seen it practiced where the incense is lit and then turned into the bowl immediately. That's
nice.
So you get a little bit of it, but.
Related to your talk, I've been reading some things about relationships because I'm trying to date and so forth, things like this. And cultures, you know, other cultures feed on it as the path, the charnel ground, being that which is kind of disgusting and, you know, really hard to be with. But that's the ground of a teaching, and the most difficult things for you to learn are in the charnel ground. Mm-hmm. And he used that analogy of relationships. Relationships will bring out your charnel ground experience, you know? So, I'm going to do a talk on that, I think.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. But I was relating that to your, mm-hmm. you're saying, you know, the difficulties are.
Right, even with certain emotions that we're not comfortable
with.
That's
our path to. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you want to say anything about the charnel grounds?
Well, as I understand it, it's a very deep practice, mm-hmm. because it's about embracing the elements of self and other that are so incredibly painful and ugly. And that we often, you know, the idea of aspects of ourself being chopped up and discarded and, you know, sort of pushed away is very hard to accept, but yet it's part of our ego structure. So the charnel grounds, as disgusting as it may be or sound, is also some of the most productive and fruitful meditations. It's a tantric practice because you're transforming what you're trying to push away and discard into something that you can accept and embrace, so you can be more fully integrated.
With your darkness and your light.
Yes, of course.
The most painful and difficult.
Absolutely.
With that which is most joyful.
Absolutely.
Happy.
Yeah. Powerful practice.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
Thank you. Yeah, I just want to thank you for the talk, Sensei. It was great. I can't wait to look at it again on YouTube. What got me was when you started talking and you were using the word tether. And I wasn't quite sure what it actually meant because of different translations. And then you used the word anchor. Then I realized what you were talking about and how the word tethered seemed much more appropriate. It seemed so much more gentle. Like it's what we do with animals. We tether them and we have to be gentle. So I just really enjoyed the figuring out what you meant by the word tethered when you were using the word tethered.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I really like that image of tethering because I can see your Declan, your little dog, right? He's so energetic, and but you have to tether them and be gentle and patient. With that energy,
yes.
It's so rambunctious, and all, you know, that's so yeah, that image is such a beautiful one for how we can treat ourselves as well. Our energy that is all over the place, right? And just sitting ourselves down and just bearing witness to it without judgment, so important. Yeah, bearing witness, practicing not knowing. We don't have to have an answer, right? We can just kind of sit into the answer.
Well, I don't know if this is, you mentioned koans, and I started to perk up because reminded me of a session that we had here with Jokai. It was a Dharma talk, and it had to do with dissecting the koan, which he brought. And, I thought that was really, really amazing and very, very insightful and inspiring. And I was hoping that we might invite him back to do that again, because I know I enjoyed it, and I think a lot of other people enjoyed it themselves too.
Mm-hmm. So we do go on practice here with advanced students who have finished the precepts, because we've got about, oh, I don't know, 300 or 400 of them. And, you know, it takes time to really kind of get a koan, you know, it takes time to, in our traditional way of practicing with them, you know, we memorize them first, and then we're trying to understand, because a lot of it is cultural, you know, the Chinese, a lot of them, so you have to understand the cultural context, and then how does this apply to you? Because in Zen, we want to be really intimate with our experience, right? Be present with. It's not so much here, right? But it's the whole heart, mind thing that's going on. So, yeah, there's different ways to work on them, for sure. That's one way. And so this is the traditional way that we work on it. And if you are really attached to, like, getting the answer, you know, then you might be disappointed in this way of practicing, because a lot of times, you know, it's an intellectual answer and it's not a whole body answer. And it's like, what is a whole body answer? Hey, what is that? So it's that the answer is pervading your whole being, not just an aha here.
Well, I think what was interesting about this session that we had, there were a number of, there were 15, 20 people, and everyone had a different idea about each line.
Yeah.
And it was, oh, is that what you saw? Oh. And then someone else would say something else. And it was,
it's very personal, definitely. Yeah, it is right. Very personal, yeah. And there's so many things you can see.
It was good to share it, though.
Yeah. And I found that koan study went faster for me when I had a steady, deep meditation practice. Because then you can be present to your life instead of, you know, thinking about something. You know what? I don't know if that's clear. But anyway, it's a beautiful practice, definitely. Koan practice is. Anyway, you can have fun with it like that, for sure.
Yeah.
And gain some insight, for sure. Absolutely.
Well, the thing is, I still have that handout on my kitchen table.
Good.
And every once in a while, I'll look at it, and I'll read it over again, and ponder about it, because it certainly is something that isn't clear.
Yeah, different
it's
things
not like
come
a reflection in the water.
Right, right. So different things come to you. It's a wonderful practice.
Yeah.
Well, when a teacher works with a student, they sort of, it takes a long time for the student to keep coming back. Oh, no, that's not it. Oh, no, that's not it. Until they finally, like you say, find the body and different kind of way of answering rather than intellectually.
Right. All right then. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Have a good day.
Thank you.